All right, this is MC1 Gamer bringing you a little bit of an unboxing with some of the most recent purchases and acquisitions that I have made. These are just a few of the terrain pieces that have come out from Games Workshop for Age of Sigmar, as well as a war host, a box set battalion for the Treemen and Dryads, and we're going to go look at that. We'll unbox that afterwards. But I first want to take a look at some of the terrain pieces. Now, I guess I shouldn't call this an unboxing because I'm not going to rip open all these boxes, but I want to talk about all these different pieces because they're really interesting on the battlefield, and I think they do some really great things to kind of change up the game. I'm going to admit right off the bat that I am a fan of the old terrain pieces. You know, the old world is far, far more interesting aesthetically to me, just because of the high fantasy that that it conveys, as opposed to a lot of this stuff, which is, you know, it's still fantasy, but it, you know, some of this stuff just, you know, it looks like it's a big departure, you know, aesthetically. And I'm just trying to get used to it, but it is beautiful. It is really cool looking. We'll just have to see what it really looks like on the table. There's rumor, of course, that some of these pieces, when all, you know, put together, are going to make up just one, you know, one of two, you know, giant fortresses, one for the Sigmarines, and I'm still going to call them Sigmarines because that's what they are to me, and the other for the Cornites, and that should be pretty impressive. So, you know, I'm going to see if I can go and build up one of those versions a little bit over time, but, you know, we've seen a lot of these things. Some people have actually seen them on the table. What I'm going to do is rather than just, you know, rip open all these boxes, I'm going to open up one of these and just show you the quality of the plastic. I'm going to talk about, you know, what they are and how they might work on the battlefield. So the first one I want to talk about is this one, the Realm Gate, the Baleful Realm Gates. There's two of these in here. So you got one for each side of the table. And I got to say, I played with this one. I haven't played with the others. And this one is a lot of fun. The rules for it are very interesting. There's some scenarios in the recent scenario book that utilizes it. They're really, really sturdy plastic. And the fact that you get two is really cool. You can play with one in the battlefield, typically in the center, for one of the most notable scenarios. Or you can play with two. And it really changes the way, you know, you'll move your army and where you focus and shift your attention for the game. So just to go and give you some idea about what some of the rules are for the Baleful Realm Gate. You've basically at the start of each round, it says the Realm Gate unleashes its magical energies. You roll two dice, and unless it was a double, you look up each result on the scenery table, and both of those results apply for that model until the next battle round. Now, that means basically that these arches could have a combination of some of the two default scenario terrain roll capabilities, you know, mystical, arcane, and the like. Which, by the way, I want to add that that chart is not a default this is how you roll up terrain chart. It's an example if you want to just throw something random out there. It's just they gave you an example of what you could do. You can do much more. You can include all the old scenery options in your own chart. They just provided one just in case you wanted something quick that just gave you some, you know, some basic details. There's still a war scroll that shows for things for fences and for Sylvaneth woods or even just regular forests. These can easily just, you know, you could just place everything, this and the old world, old school medieval fantasy type stuff, all on the table in any way you want, as well as just standard woods and hills. Roll for random effects if you want, or look for the scrolls that accompany them, and make up, you know, whatever board you want. It can be as thick and dense of terrain as you want, or just, you know, roll up randomly. It's up to you. It really is. And they just, the wording even says it. This is just a chart, just in case you needed something quick to, you know, for some of the basic terrain pieces. In any case, this one can use some of that chart as the basis, and it changes each turn. So they're very, very cool looking. I can't wait to paint these up. And I've seen already my buddy who I've played a game with. We played the Stormcast Eternals versus my son's Ogre list, which was, you know, one of the earlier versions of his list, and it just changed the way we played. You know, we were just racing towards these to try and move through them. So again, get to the details. You roll, and if it was a double, then there's some unstable magics blast out of the Realm Gate, and everybody within 3 inches suffers die 3 mortal wounds. Now that's that's pretty severe. You're getting like a risk with this. You might have some positive effects from the table, but you also might have something pretty hazardous. But then you have a situation where you can utilize the relegates to move around the table, and that could really change up tactics for the game. So rather than just march at each other, you might be using the realm gate to get you shift around the board. If you have a sudden death option for you know a piece of terrain or for a target on the table, a character, a hero rather of your enemy for sudden death, that could be it. If there's a scenario with objectives, whether you adapt scenarios from the scenario books or you make your own, these can really change up. I think that if there's any one piece that I would pick up, this would be the one, and especially because you get two of them. It's just two nice pieces of terrain. Let's see what the effects are. So Hazardous Journey. You can move out units from your army through this Baleful Realm Gate in each of your movement phases. In order to do so, all models in the unit must start the movement phase within 6 inches. You remove the unit from the battlefield and then roll a die for each model in the unit. On a roll of one, it becomes lost and never returned. So it's basically a casualty. The surviving models are then set up within 6 inches of any other realm gate or within 6 inches of the edge of the battlefield. All right, that's all. It doesn't have anything to do with proximity to enemy units. 6 inches from the edge of the battlefield. You could be basically right behind enemy lines next to their war machines or their rear units or characters hiding out. This counts as the units move for that phase, which means those units who then teleported through the realm gate can still charge. And they, of course, can still contribute to the shooting phase, for example. Now, here's where it's commanding the gate really has an effect. If you have a wizard or a priest that's within 6 inches, you can and a unit attempts to move through it, you can re-roll the dice for any models that do get lost. So if you have a wizard that is also close to 6 inches, which I highly recommend, and you do roll one for any of those guys that are, you know, that move through and you are going to lose the model, you get to re-roll it. If you roll a one the second time, they're gone. But it gives you a huge advantage if you're going to try and use these realm gates. So definitely use that. So that's that one. And again, I didn't take a video of that bat rep, but it was probably the best Age of Sigmar game that I've played so far. So I'm going to put this one to the side, and we're going to take a look at another one. Now this one, you know, I've seen some stuff on another channel. I think Minigame Wargaming was the one where they kind of talked about this and how some of the molds were a little warped. I haven't really taken a look at it. It's a really nice looking model. I mean, take a look at that. That just looks very interesting. It's not, you know, medieval fantasy. It's not, you know, it's not the old world. It definitely looks like something new, and it's got some interesting mechanics. Before I even go into what it does, let's go ahead and open up the box and see what, you know, the quality of the plastic. And I'm just going to open just this one piece here. Look, this is really, it's strong. It's thick plastic. It doesn't, you know, it's not bending. It's these pieces are really, really, they're nicely articulated. I know some people have criticized it. They don't like the detail on these. I got to disagree. I think these are very, very paintable, very interesting. I mean, you know, you really have very few pieces, and it's kind of costly, I think, the Archway, you know, for what you get. Yes, I agree. But look at all the detail on this. Look at that. Oh, man, there's so much in there. And there's so much detail to play with and the highlight. You know, I just can't wait to put this out on the table and see, you know, see how it plays, of course. And that's the money shot right there. Look at that. You know, the three-headed dragon, you know, fighting what looks like potentially Sigmar himself. You know, again, I have to admit, I agree with people that have criticized some of the aesthetic. It's not necessarily my cup of tea, but it is still attractive, and it is Age of Sigmar, so, you know, you can put just about anything out there. So let's take a look real quickly at the rules for this. It's an arch, and it has a very interesting rule as far as cover is concerned. First of all, it's considered sinister, so any units within 3 inches will cause fear, and that will subtract one from the bravery of any enemy units that were within 3 inches of one or more of those units that cause fear, unless they cause fear themselves, unless they're right next to the and they as well cause fear. Shelter. Any models from a unit that are within 3 inches of the Ophidian archway and are on the same side of it, then use and receive the benefits of cover against attacks made by models that are on the other side of the archway. All right, so this basically where a lot of terrain is not considered you know, to provide you with cover. You know, walls in the scenic in the scenery war skulls will do that as well. You should look those up, if you, especially if you're using any walls. This actually will provide you with cover. And if you don't know what the cover rules are, typically you have to have your entire unit on top of the actual terrain piece. It even can be just a hill, but it's, you know, a forest or a building, whatever. If they're all occupying that terrain piece, if they're all within the boundaries of that terrain piece, they will then get the benefit of cover, and it's not a modifier on to hit. What it is it's a +1 to your saves. So if you have a 3-up save, obviously if you have a 4-up save, it goes to 3. If you have a 5-up save, it goes to 4. It just makes it easier to counter some Wrens. It's pretty good. Then it has this ability called Awaken Graven Carvings. In your hero phase, any friendly hero that is within 3 inches can attempt to awaken the spirits residing within and strike down their foe. And to do so, you know, an enemy model within 6 inches, you select one enemy model within 6 inches of the Ophidian archway and roll a die. If the result is greater than or equal to the model's bravery, it is struck down and slain. Wow, that's pretty severe. It's probably just going to be mostly rank and file type troops because honestly, it really is. Even the most average heroes tend to have like at least 6. You know, so you're going to have many situations where you're going to have to roll 6. So it's not going to be easy, and there's only going to be very few of these guys. It's going to be just basic rank and file troops that have low bravery. But you know, if it's a multi wound troop, you know, it can be a big deal. If the result is a 1, however, you must roll a second die, and if the result of the second die is greater than or equal to the bravery of the model that attempted to awaken the grave carvings, it is itself then grabbed into the walls and slain, so it's a little bit of a risk. Make sure that you have a nice and high bravery, if you're going to use the Ophidian archway. But adds a little bit of dimension into the game and looks kind of cool on the battlefield. If it's the aesthetic that you're interested in, well, you know, pick one up and add it to the playstyle of your game. This one is an interesting one. I really am interested in seeing how this one works. I'm not going to open up any of the other ones yet. And apologies for the light. You know, I don't have a studio. I'm doing this in the comfort of my home. Okay, so this is the Numinous Oculum. So I'm just going to call it the Oculum because Numinous is a $25 handle. It's a little too much, too many syllables for me. Syllables. Okay, so scenery rules. First of all, it's arcane, so any wizard that's within 3 inches of the Numinous Oculum, the Oculum, adds 1 to the casting or unbinding rolls. That's pretty good. You want to occupy this baby with a wizard and with some bodyguards to protect that wizard. And it's also a multi-level item. This is pretty big, this piece. So you're gonna see that on the back of it, it has obviously a shelf, it has some areas underneath. It has a little stairway, it looks like. There's a lot to this. There's a lot to the to this piece. You know, you can occupy the center here. That's pretty cool. So magical fulcrum. Wizards that are within 3 inches of the globe on the Numinous Oculum can attempt to cast a piercing veil spell. And they basically get an extra spell. So the piercing veil is a casting value of 5. And if you cast it, you can successfully glimpse into the future. And what that means is that you can reroll, you can change the result of any one die made for the caster or other friendly model to the result of your choosing. So basically you take one die, it's not going to have a dramatic effect. It could be the result of a charge, it could be the result of a hit or a wound or a spell casting or unbinding. You can make one of those. That's nice. Then it has Zone of Nullification. So you roll a die if a unit is affected by an enemy spell that is within 6 inches of the terrain piece. On a 5 or more, the spell is drained of its eldritch power. That's pretty good. So there's a little bit of an anti-magic zone here that you can take advantage of, and it will have no effect. The nullification result is made after any attempts to unbind the spell. So you're really taking a little bit of a chance. It's kind of like, you know, you want to unbind and see if the terrain piece takes care of it for you. You don't know. It's a little bit of a risk. But this one looks really cool on the table. And I can see this one, you know, look, again, there's some stuff that I've seen in the old world that could really kind of look comparable to this. It does look a little high-techy in some respects. It could fit into 40K pretty easily. But, you know, Age of Sigmar is kind of a little techie, magic-y fantasy. So this certainly works with it, and I think it's going to be fun to see this on the table. And I like the idea that it's a non-standard type of a terrain piece from what we normally see. It's got some dimension to it. All right. The Dragon Fate Dais. Now this one looks really cool, and look at that. It's got a stairway. It's got these dragon pieces. All this little mystical stuff coming out. I really like this. I'm not so sure about the rules on it. I have to go read it up again. I remember when I first read it, I wasn't too big on what it could do on the table. So I'm going to go and perch this so you have a better view while I go and look up the rules. And so let's do it like that. There you go. And so it's going to be a very cool to paint these up. So, the scenery rules. All right. You do not use the scenery rules in Age of Sigmar. When you have it, any model that's atop the upper part of the dais is shielded by the divine light of the gods. Wow. This thing looks like it should be, you know, evil. I guess it's not. You roll dice for whenever a wound or a mortal wound is allocated to the model, and then you add one to that to the roll if the model is blessed, and that will come up in just a second. And you subtract one from the roll if the model is cursed, and we'll see about that in a second. So the pool of sacrifice. If any of your units within 3 inches of the model in your hero phase, you can declare that one of them is making a sacrifice. If you do so, the unit suffers die 3 mortal wounds, but you can add one to the save rolls for that unit until your next hero phase. That's pretty good. So these guys here defending this dais are all probably getting that +1 to their save by just basically sacrificing a few mortal wounds onto the unit. So you better have either a lot of guys, or you better have guys that have lots of wounds. So then you beseech the gods. If the priest from your army is standing in the upper platform of the Dragon Fate dais in your hero phase, he can pray, and then you roll and you look on the chart, and that's where you get the possibility of a curse or of some kind of a boon. On a 1, the priest draws the attention of a rival god and is cursed, and you must subtract 1 from all his hit rolls made for the priest for the rest of this battle. Okay, that's the rest of the battle, the entire game. They cannot pray during this battle. So that's it, they're done. On a 2-3, the priest is ignored, nothing happens. 4-5, the priest or a friendly unit within 12 inches of the priest is blessed. The blessed unit can add 1 to all hit rolls for the rest of the battle. A unit can only be blessed once per battle. So that's pretty good. You can get +1 a hit. Wow. There's some units that would tremendously benefit from that. Of course, you're taking some risks. And then on a 6, the priest and 1 friendly unit within 12 inches of the priest are blessed by the gods, and the blessed unit can add 1 to all hit rolls for the rest of the battle. A unit can only be blessed once per battle. So that's pretty good, too. So it's the priest and a unit. So that is the Dragon Fate Dais. Excellent terrain piece, but, you know, very risky. I'm not sure how much I would kind of, you know, take my chances on this one. You know, you're kind of getting a lot of risk for the reward. Then this. I've been looking forward to seeing this. I mean, I don't know. I never was really into the Treeman and the Dryads, but I got to say, I love the rules. I love the scenarios in the new scenario book. And I'm going to pop this one open. Let's see if I can open this thing up. I love the scenarios in the scenario book, and I'm really interested. This is what it has in the box. It has 3 tree men, which you can make in combination. Of course, you can make 2, you know, tree lords, 2 tree lord agents, and I guess 1 Durthu. You can make any combination of there. I'd do one of all 3. 1 branch wraith, which I bought a second branch wraith. I'm not sure if that's going to be a good thing, but I did. I've also bought a unit of treekin, but for this particular formation, there's an actual special formation that you get a number of abilities for. You need 2 units of these dryads. It doesn't really say how many. So you get 2 in this box. You get basically 2 units of, I believe, 16. And that's a lot of models there in this box. It's not cheap. I mean, they just basically repackaged this from the one that kind of didn't sell going back a while. And so let's see if I can get this thing opened up. So there's what's in there. So you got the branch wraith, a whole lot of dryads, and these guys. And the abilities for these are, you know, you'll probably know. Well, let's see if we got this upside down. So the abilities for these are in addition to whatever other abilities you have with, you know, on the boar scrolls. But now this is a formation. So I'm trying to do this with one hand, guys. So let's see. All right. Always a challenge. Yes, I need a tripod. Yeah. Yeah. That's a lot of plastic. And that's probably the branch wraith that's in. Yep. And unfortunately, that's Branch Wraith. It is a fine cast Branch Wraith, it looks like. Does it say? Yeah, it is fine cast. That's too bad. I don't really like that it's fine cast, but oh well, it's not the first thing that I have that's fine cast. So you're going to get a whole bunch of these dryads, and at the bottom, you're going to find all those nice oval. That's the only difference. It's got these oval bases for the Tree Lord. And these bases, these are not even the biggest of the bases. These are more like, you know what these are? These are the monstrous infantry type bases. And of course, enough of these round ones here to make the dryads. So some of the special abilities are for this particular formation are, let's see, Forest Spirits. Instead of setting up the Tree Lord Ancient or unit of dryads, from the battalion of on the battlefield, you can place them to one side and say that it is set up as part of your army hidden in the hidden sanctuaries. In any of your movement phase, you can transport the unit to the battlefield. When you do so, set up all models within 3 inches of a Sylvaneth wood and more than 9 inches from any enemy models. This is their movement for the phase. They basically teleport in. Now, I got to point out something about this, and I'm going to go and move this up here, and I'll move this over here. Let's take a look at this. This is the War Scroll. You get 2 units of Dryads, 1 Tree Lord Ancient, 3 Tree Lords or Tree Lord Ancients. Basically, you're deciding which ones of these are. You get 3 of those big boys, and then you get 2 Sylvaneth Woods. Now, 2 Sylvaneth Woods. I am going to use this to try and explain something with the Sylvaneth Woods. Before I do, let me go ahead and say, Secret Grove. The battalion's Sylvaneth woodlands are set up on the battlefield after all pieces of scenery are set up, but before the battle begins and either side sets up their armies. You can place them anywhere in the battlefield. This is key. Let me go ahead and see if I can go pull this up. I'm using the app for this. And where are we going to see some Sylvaneth Woods? So there's a Sylvaneth Wood. Let's go pull that up. All right. It is 2 or more. So you get at least 2 of these. I would say do 2. Don't get crazy. All right. But it's at least 2 of these these in each wood. So you get basically 4 of these sections from the actual Citadel Woods. And you get to place them anywhere. And so you put 2 of them. It makes up the wood. I would probably connect them. And then you place them on strategically around the board anywhere after the terrain has been decided upon or ruled up. And here is the rules. You roll a dice for each model that makes a run through or across the wood. By the way, this is this does not count for these guys in the battle in the battalion. None of the Sylvaneth will have to do this. Also, no monsters or heroes will. But anyone who rolls a 1 when they're running through this. If they make a run or a charge through these woods, are slain. No rerolls, a 1, and it's gone. So this entire battalion is immune to it, plus any enemy monsters or heroes would be immune to it, and any friendly monsters or heroes. Roused by magic. Roll a dice whenever a spell is successfully cast within 6 inches of the Sylvaneth Wood. On a roll of 5 or more, the forest is roused by magical energies. This happens. All units within 1 inch of the Sylvaneth Wood suffer die 3 mortal wounds. Sylvaneth are not attacked by this. So this is a horrible thing for anybody who is not a Sylvaneth. But you can try to do that. And there are other benefits for these units that are... Let's see if I can go find this. This is a nice run to try and see if I can go and get the actual dryads and treemen. They get some extra abilities. If they're within a certain distance of the woods, well, it crashed, yay. If they're within a certain distance of the woods, they they're basically, like, I think they like get a little Nurgle ability. And I want to confirm that once I find the actual, here we go, the actual units. So we have, I'm not even going to bother with the tree men. I just want to look at what the dryads get. So I think they must be further down the line here. Let's go find the dryads. Okay, so here's the dryads. We're going to use, so we'll try the branch wraith and the dryads. We'll go to my battle. Okay, so the dryads. This is what I found very interesting. The dryads, who are really not much to look at, they really move really quick. But they only have a 5-up save, 1 wound each. They're pretty big. They do have a range of 2. They get 2 attacks, 4-up, 4-up. But the ability is that you subtract 1 from all to hit rolls, shooting and combat, against any of these guys that if they're within 3 inches of these Sylvaneth would. Further, if you're in your own combat phase, you can enrapture one enemy unit that is within 3 inches, add 1-2 to hit rolls for attacks made by this unit against the enraptured in that combat phase. So that's pretty cool. And then we have the fact that if you have a lot of dryads, you can add 1 to the results of their saves, which gives them a 4-up save. So you have to have at least 12 of these models, which is pretty good. You can definitely do that. In this case, I would probably make 2 groups of 16, and that would make it 32. I'd probably get some extra dryads to port in because there's a mechanic for that in some of the scenarios that are in the first scenario book that are really cool for the treekin tree, tree lords. What are they called? The Sylvaneth. That's what they're called. Sylvaneth. And some of these abilities, so these guys are going to be -1 to be hit, and that's pretty big if they're close to the woods. So you really want to get those freebie woodlands, Sylvaneth woodlands to include in this battalion. You do get 2 of them, and that's really what this is all about. Let me go pull up the battalion once again. You can see that you are entitled to 2 of these, and each of them has at least 2 bases. Don't be a douche. Don't take more. Take 2. All right, because it's a powerful ability, and we don't want to go overboard. Even in a competitive sense, I wouldn't use more than 2. But you can take at least 2, so that's 4 of those bases. Get your own trees, cut out some bases of the same pattern, and you're good to go. So there you have it. All these different things that I just recently got. Hope it was a nice insight. I know other people have shown some of this stuff before, but just going over some of the rules, it really can change. Use scenery, people. Use terrain. Make your board a little bit more interesting, and you won't have just a run into the middle scrum battle. Some of these terrain pieces are really going to change. Just even without the scenarios from the scenario book, you can really see, at least I did, especially with the portal, how it can change how you play the game. Thanks for tuning in. Have a great day, everybody.